Thanks to Armageddon Expo, this morning I'm talking to fantasy author Terry Brooks. His credits include 23 New York Times best-selling novels and over 21 million books in print. He's one of the biggest-selling living fantasy writers. Welcome, Terry.
Thank you. I always like it when they add the word living.
Yeah.
Makes me feel so much better.
Yeah, well, I suppose, yeah. It seemed a bit odd, but that's the way it was worded on Wikipedia.
I know. I don't know why they did that. I guess they want to be sure.
Better selling ones. Better that are dead.
Yeah, well, if they're dead, they're not selling. I guess they could
they
be.
They
are. Lord of the Rings. Yeah,
Lord of the Rings. There you go. You're right. Okay, well, anyway.
You studied English literature at college before becoming a lawyer, and only later started publishing fantasy. When did you know you wanted to be a writer?
Oh, I knew I wanted to be a writer when I was 10. At least that's the last time I can remember, or the earliest time I can remember, really knowing this is what I wanted to do. So I knew all my life what I wanted to do, I just didn't know how to get there. And it took a lot of years to figure that out, and a lot of false starts, needless to say. But eventually, I did get the job done, and it really helped to be focused all those years on where I wanted to go.
So that explains why you studied English at college.
Well, yeah, I studied English lit at college after freshman year because after freshman year, when I was a math major, I discovered I'd hit the wall on math and actually didn't, not only was I not doing well, I didn't care. So at that point, because I was always a reader, I just shifted over to do English, which made more sense anyway. I to this day, I'm not entirely sure what in the world made me think math was the way I should go.
And then you studied law.
Yeah, well, that's another story, of course. That was to keep from starving to death. I went to law school because my parents and many of my, my parents thought it was a really good idea if I did that. And they had many friends who were attorneys in their circle, and I had known some of them. And so I thought, well, yeah, you know, I could study law, that'd be fine. And then at the same time, I could learn organizational skills and perhaps find some time to write. And then I wouldn't starve to death in a garret somewhere waiting to get published. I'd have a real job and people would respect me and so on.
Did it work?
It worked better than I thought because I went to law school in 66, 67 was my freshman year. I discovered after year one that I despised law and I hated being in law school. And I was ready to quit, but my parents talked me out of it and said, no, hang in there. And in order to find a way to balance my life while I was in law school that would make it bearable, I started writing sort of Shannara. And that was really the turning point because suddenly I was writing again, which I hadn't been. I was studying less and my grades went up. So I thought, well, this is working very well for me. And then I stuck with it, of course, afterwards.
So it took 10 years from starting to write it at law school until it was published?
Yeah, I there were gaps of time in there, though, where I put it aside for various reasons. I wrote it twice from scratch because I didn't like it the first time, so I wrote it again. And then I sat around for a while afterwards thinking, well, I don't know if it's good enough kind of thing. And then at one point I thought, oh, the heck with it, I'm just going to send it off and see what happens, and that's another process. So there were a lot of gaps of time in there where things were happening, but not very quickly.
Wow.
Weird, yeah, I know.
No, well, actually, it seems like it's not that unusual a story for writers to have these hiatuses.
Yes.
So to speak.
Yeah, I think, well, some of them are enforced, not necessarily of your own making, but they come about for other reasons. Sometimes you have to think, not write. And that's in some ways harder than the writing part, is to just sit down and start thinking about how you want to put a story together and getting it to a point where you're actually ready to sit down and start writing it. It's kind of a mystical process at best. I don't know how to describe it really because every writer I know has a different approach and a different process for getting a book started and finished.
Mm. Yes. And speaking of different authors, rumor has it that you credit William Faulkner as a key influence in your writing style. Is this true?
It is. I started reading Faulkner in high school. Liked liked him quite a bit. Hard to read, but with great insights and a real sense of what the world was about. And I went to college, and if you're going to major in English, you have to have a thesis at the end, and I decided I was going to make my thesis on William Faulkner. And so I read all of his books, and so I was pretty familiar with his work, and really he influenced me in my thinking about how not only in the craft side of things, but the whole idea of a world contained in a county, one county, Yoctopanoffa County in Mississippi, of families, generations of families growing up through decades and interacting with each other, some of them trying to destroy others, a lot of vitriol involved, a sense of rich and poor, with the rich becoming too morally ambiguous and the poor with no morals whatsoever pulling them down and taking their place. I liked all that a lot, and I thought, you know, this whole thing of what's right and what's wrong and how you get ahead in the world, I want to use that. Mm-hmm. And so that became kind of the bedrock for when I finally read Tolkien in when I was in college, I think it was in my junior year, and thought, I don't want to write about this world, I want to write about that world, but I want to graft on the Faulknerian concepts and storylines and types of characters and use them. That was really how I got there.
Wow.
Yeah.
So are there any other authors that have particularly influenced you?
Well, I've been influenced by many, many authors because I'm a reader. I've read books since I was a kid. My parents were readers. They influenced me that way. I went through, I think, stages in my life where I was enamored of, you know, dog and horse stories and young detective stories and science fiction and everything in science fiction. European adventure story writers in my teens, all those writers, Dumas and so forth, that I was fascinated with and loved their stories. But I didn't read fantasy, and I didn't even I read Wizard of Oz and that sort of thing, and Tarzan, but mostly no. And it wasn't until I came on Tolkien that I thought, this is a format I like. The whole idea of what I think he really invented, which was the poor, nobody special person who becomes the linchpin for whether or not the world is going to be saved. That person is as powerful as the highest king. And I thought, I think that's right.
Yeah, the Hobbit's just
the Hobbit, yeah.
Amazing.
The Hobbit and the Lord, yeah.
Yeah. Nikki, a writing student, wants to know, how have you done it? How have you written so many books and so many best-selling novels?
practice. I don't know. Tell her. I don't think anybody has an answer to that. I think when you start out as a writer, you just want to write one book, and if you're lucky, get one book published and sort of claw your way out of the mire. But you never think about, well, I think 50 books will be fine for my career, or maybe 150 or whatever. I don't think writers who are successful don't think in those terms, because it's too hard to even conceive of it. Once you've done it, you know how much it takes. So you just sort of, one book follows another book, and that's how you do it.
Well, you haven't just had, well, I suppose in your life you've had one book following another book. But in your writing career, you started with Sword of Shannara and went forward, and then you went back in time and wrote the prequels leading up to that time. So how did that all work for you?
Well, I think that it has more to do with not getting bored with what you're doing, and challenging yourself occasionally so that you don't just be too complacent about your work. So, you know, after writing three Shannara books over a period of roughly 15 years, that was it for me. I thought I might never write another one of these. I've had it. So then I went off and wrote three books in the Magic Kingdom series in order to get back on track, and then I was ready to go back into the Shannara world and write them. And I've always done that. I go in and out of three different sets of books or some other projects, the occasional movie adaptation, that sort of thing. And then, of course, at some point, readers say, well, what about what happened before? What about the old world? How did that happen? So after a while, you think, well, you know, maybe I could do that. Maybe I should go back and fill that in. So that's really how that all came about. And I'm still, you know, mired in trying to get all that filled in at some point before I finally kick the bucket.
Speaking of movie novelizations, you've written Phantom Menace, Star Wars The Phantom Menace, and Hook. Mm-hmm. How different was it to write in other people's sandboxes to writing in your own sandbox?
It's not hard at all, actually. I think you probably are better off if you pick something that is in your realm of type of fiction. So I fantasy, you know, Hook and Star Wars are both basically kinds of adventure stories. They're kinds of fantasy stories. Even when I talked to George Lucas about what he wrote, and when we first sat down to talk, and I said, are you sure you got the right guy here? You know, I don't write science fiction. He says, well, I don't make science fiction movies. And I said, oh, well, what do you make? He said, I make adventure story movies. And I said, oh, all right, well, that's what I write, so I guess maybe we're on the same line. But it really has to do with the cooperation of the movie people. If they're very cooperative, as the Lucas people were and as George was, it becomes very easy to do the job. You can write one of those in 90 days, no problem. If they're obstreperous and difficult, as the Hook people were, not so much. It becomes a much more difficult teeth-pulling process. So I don't want to say I'll never do it again, but I would have to have the right project for me to do it. Because it is very demanding if the other people aren't extremely cooperative.
It sounds like you like the collaborative process when you're doing movie novelization.
Yeah, I think that's true. I think that's a good way of putting it. Mm.
So what does the future hold for you?
Well, probably no retirement. I don't know. I'm working on, the biggest things that are happening is I have a TV show coming out next year based on Shannara, based on Elfstones of Shannara, to be particular.
It's not starting with the Sword of Shannara.
No, we wanted something. You know, the trouble with the sword is there's no female roles. That's anathema for TV shows. They want strong female characters as well as male characters, for the most part, and particularly in something like a fantasy story, a big epic story. So, and besides, I felt like Elfstones is a better book. It's a better book. So that's what we started with, and they're going to base the series on that. But they're looking to do a long-run series, not just 1 year and out. And they'll start filming in January, and they're casting now, and they're doing all this pre-stuff. So, and I'm involved in that because I have participatory rights in the writing and editing the episodes that are being written, so that's keeping me hopping. And we also have a movie coming from based on Magic Kingdom for sale from Warner Brothers that will probably happen sometime in the next 2 years.
How much can you reveal about what's happening with these projects?
Well, I can reveal that they're filming the TV show in New Zealand. I can tell you that. That hasn't been put out there yet, but I can put it out now. And they will be drawing on professionals who work in this area. So that's kind of exciting. Other than that, I'm not allowed to talk about it for too much. We're running a 10-episode first season, and we'll see how that goes. I don't think they've settled exactly on when they're going to release it because they want to see how things work with the filming part of it. I don't know anything about the casting yet, probably just as well. I think that they're out there looking around to see what they like and don't like, and I'm not really a part of that process. So it's coming along, but the Warner Brothers, the movie, I can talk a little bit about that. That features is starring an actor named Steve Carell, and he's also producing, and he's been really supportive of the project, and his entourage and friends are very supportive of it. So that's kind of carried it through, and they're getting ready to do another draft of the screenplay. So that one's moving also, but it seems like it's moving so slow I can hear, the earth shift for before anything really matters. But so that's kind of exciting.
Oh, it's awesome.
Yeah.
So we're definitely going to see Shannara following in the footsteps of Game of Thrones.
Yeah. We say the pitch was, it's Game of Thrones for the whole family.
And what a good improvement that'll
be. Exactly. You won't have to send everybody under 15 to bed. That's a slot that needs filled. I think there's a real need for that sort of thing. The movies for Lord of the Rings are over. There's really nothing that's come along to take its place. They have a lot of young dystopian young adult novels out there that are being made into movies, but they're kind of one note because they all feature the same storyline with the same young female character trying to lift herself and her society out. So this will be a different kind of story. I think people will like it.
I am sure they will. Well, thank you very much for talking to Dark Matter.
Oh, you're very welcome. Thank you for having me on the show.